What up, guys? Epicreality here with War Stories through episode 3. I've been late on these for a while. I'm sorry. It's a habit I have. Like, I can't record a video during the week because I'm working on other videos. So it's so difficult to get footage. I'm playing with friends constantly. Streaming is not possible right now because of the whole router situation, but I hope you guys enjoy this video. It's one of the hardest rushes I've ever had in Metro. I'm only showing the first part of it because if I showed you the whole thing, it'd be a 2-hour long video, or at least an hour. And we ended up pushing all the way up to A, but you only get to see C and B and part of A. But anyways, I used a lot of shotgun and a lot of SCAR. I'm practicing with new weapons. I'm only have 22 hours in this game, so if you see new weapons, this is why. And if you hate shotguns, it required shotguns in this. There's no way I could not use them. But anyways, I hope you guys enjoy this. And if my newbiness is too much, I'm sorry, but we're all new at some games. So it's fun to see how I progress in each video. Like, you see me in the first two videos, I'm doing amazing. In this video, since I'm practicing with new weapons, I'm like 12th on the leaderboard. But I'm playing with level 100s, and I'm a level 15. So, nevertheless, I hope you guys enjoy, and I will see you in the video. Yeah. I'm such a nub! Okay, so the first war story that we're going to be talking about is called Hans... Well, the first guy that we're going to be talking about is Hans Scharff. I'm probably not saying his name right, but hopefully I am. And basically, he was the gentle interrogator. Now, basically, from movies and shows, you guys should understand that interrogation usually involves really bad physical abusing and just basically, like, the worst things possible just to get information out of people. And usually, the people end up dying while doing it. So, basically, he was not meant to be part of the German army, he was in the German army, but anyways, he lived in South Africa with his family, and but he was drafted to the German army when he was visiting there and when the war broke out. So his wife convinced the general to put him in interrogation instead of front lines, because he was drafted for front lines, and if you're drafted for front lines, you have like a 1 in 10 chance of living, or even worse. But anyways, but through a series of mistakes and coincidences, he became the lead interrogator for the Allied pilots felled in France and Germany. So he would interrogate Allied pilots or pilots that would fly over from France to Germany. And basically, having seen a prisoner abused when he was an assistant, he vowed to himself that he would never do the same. He would never hurt a human while interrogating. But instead of hurting people, his technique was being kind. And basically, his success was using kindness to get what he wanted. So basically, he would have a really nice conversation and he would get information out of them. So it's been found that not only does one tend to get more information and more accurate information from the prisoner, but the prisoner is often aware of how much information they've given away. So imagine a movie that explores this technique approach rather than 24's technique, which was attack them, hurt them, physically abuse them. But anyways, after the war, Scharff divorced and moved to the United States, and married an American and finding success in his new career as a mosaic artist. So, and as a bonus, one of his works appear in the Magic Kingdom at Disneyland. So, what a great ending. Usually the endings end with, like, he died to an explosive bullet to the face, or he died in war. Luckily, that day he lived one more day. It's just stuff like that. But this is, I mean, if people could be interrogated this way instead of getting hurt and, like, needles being shoved up under their fingernails, that'd be great. I mean, it's good to see the positive side of something for once. So, moving on from the positives, going to another positive-ish, is called, the next story is called The Ghost Army. So, the 23rd Headquarters Special Troop Soldier Unit, also known as the Ghost Army, used fakery and misformation to deceive the enemy throughout the European instance. Throughout the European theater. So, basically, it was a 1,100 men unit, and they would use fakery and they would speakers to make themselves seem like a way bigger threat. So basically, They pretended to be much larger groups, and with the use of 500-pound speakers that could be heard at a 15-mile radius, they sent fake radio transmissions to distract it from actual missions and deployed handmade blow-up tanks and fake observation planes. So basically, they were spies of anything. And they marked their tanks with chalk and sewed on fake patches to prevent other units and hide from enemy spies. And basically, this prevented them from... Basically, this whole experience was prevented from being spread out to the public until... Well, basically, the whole American Army was unaware of this until one of the... an illustrator, Arthur Shilstone, wrote about it in 1985. And they did a PBS documentary on it in 2013. Now, this would be a good movie. I mean, these two experiences really show a positive side of things. I mean, positive interrogation and fakery instead of going and blowing up all the enemy tanks and stuff. Okay, so this next one is the exact opposite of the first story. This guy's name is Vera Atkins. He is the ruthless interrogator. So Vera Atkins placed 400 agents out on the field. He had trained them for months, and he was teaching them the ropes and accounting for every detail of their new identities. So when the war ended in 1945, with over 100 agents unaccounted for, she made it... Oh, this is a woman. She made it her personal mission to solve the stories of these missing women herself. So these were all women that she was teaching. Wow, that's different. Not saying anything wrong, but she muscled her way through and officially joined the British War Crimes Commission, and she was known for her ruthless interrogation skills. She notes in a report that the commandant of Auschwitz admitting to this horrible crimes before lunch. So she would admit to the people what she's done, and Atkins was part of several such investigations, but she also used the information to forward her search for her spies. Carved names on jail cell walls, sketches from all former Vogue sketch artists who'd survived multiple concentration camps, intercepted letters, all were recorded and used as part of her investigation. So although she was a ruthless interrogator, she was doing it for her country, and she was doing it to get the information out. This is kind of like a not good way of doing things, but anyways. Pretty much, this lady, she also had a nice side. She was helping find her 100 missing, her 100 missing agents. So, I mean, the way she's doing this is really smart. She's using all these little things to get in and go through. I mean, this is a completely different than the full story. But anyways, when she returned to the United States, she focused on publicizing and memorializing her forgotten agents. So much that she appears briefly in some of the movies made of their lives. But Atkins was a secretive woman, and no movie yet has been made of her incredible tendency and loyalty to these agents. So, I mean, there is a positive side to it. I mean, she's trying to save her agents, and she's trying to find them. But anyways... These first and third stories are completely different, and I mean, interrogation isn't right. I mean, war isn't right, although I'm playing Battlefield 3 here. But anyways, I'm not gonna get into this conversation because I feel like there's gonna be a lot of argument. And there's a couple things I want to address. Yes, I'm talking about war while there's Battlefield 3 footage. It's not really, I don't see how it should be viewed as wrong. I mean, this is a fictional video game and people say it's like realistic. I mean, the makers of the video game try to make this realistic, but it's basically 100% not realistic. I mean, when you get hurt and you die, you instantly respawn. And it's just, if you think this game is realistic, I don't think you're really right in the head, because look at this. It's a fictional cartoon video game. And, okay, Frankie made a video about this. He, in one of his war stories. He basically explained that, because some people were complaining that it seemed realistic, he said that if this was realistic and you got shot, it would literally break your computer for 6 months. And, I mean, you'd literally have to take a break for 6 months. And if you died, it'd just break your computer. That would be realistic. This, on the other hand, is not realistic. But anyways, I don't really want to start a huge argument. I hope you guys enjoyed this. And I guess I'll see you guys in the next video. Hopefully you enjoyed the Nubby gameplay. I was attempting to use shotguns and I used a new one, but anyways, we did not end up winning this match. We got close, we almost had him there, but anyways, I hope you guys enjoyed, and I will see you in the next video. Until next time, Epicreality out.